Good morning, Historic First Baptist. Good morning to everyone that is here in person and all of our online viewers. Are y'all excited to be in the house of the Lord? For truly, this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and we will be glad in it. Come on, let's stand all over the building. Let's rise to our feet as we make our first declaration. Anybody come to bless the Lord this morning? He deserves all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. We are excited and we are elated to be here this morning to worship the Lord. So come on, clap those hands and let's worship him together. He deserves all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. We freely give it to him because he deserves it. Let me see you clap those hands and let's worship him together. Come on and bless the Lord with me. Bless the Lord with me. Come on and bless the Lord with me. Bless the Lord with me. Let's sing. Come on and bless
the Lord with me.
Come on, bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord with me.
He's so deserving of the Lord.
Bless the Lord with me.
Sing, bless the Lord with
me. Bless the Lord with me.
Stay right there. Oh, come on and bless the Lord
with me.
Come on and bless the
Lord. Bless the Lord with me.
Bless the Lord with
me. Bless the Lord with me.
Oh, bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord with
me. Now let's raise it up. Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He's so deserving of the glory.
Hallelujah.
Oh,
Amen. Praise the Lord. All right. I shall read our Old Testament coming from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 10, verse 12 through 22. And it reads, "And now, Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you? He requires only that you fear the Lord your God and live in a way that pleases him and love him and serve him with all your heart and soul. And you must always obey the Lord's command and decrees that I am giving you today for your own good. Look, the highest heavens and the earth and everything in it all belong to the Lord your God. Yet the Lord chose your ancestors as the objects of his love. And he chose you, the descendants, above all other nations as is evidenced today. Therefore, change your hearts and stop being stubborn. For the Lord your God is the God of gods and the Lord of lords. He is the great God, the mighty and awesome God, who shows no partiality and cannot be bribed. He ensures that orphans and widows receive the justice. And as for the migrants, quote, end quote, he shows love to the foreigners living among you and gives them food and clothing. So you, too, must show love for foreigners. For you yourself were once foreigners in the land of Egypt. You must fear the Lord your God and worship him and cling to him. Your oath must be in his name alone. He alone is your God and the only one who is worthy of your praise and the one who has done these mighty miracles that you have seen with your own eyes. When your ancestors went down into Egypt, there were only 70 of them. But now the Lord your God has made you as numerous as the stars in the sky." Amen. New Testament coming from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verse 14 through 25. And it reads, "For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. So you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Instead, you received God's Spirit when he adopted you as his own children. Now we call him Abba, Father, for his Spirit joins with our spirit to affirm that we are God's children. And since we are his children, we are his heirs. In fact, together with Christ, we are heirs of God's glory. But if we are to share his glory, we must also share his suffering. Yet, what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory he revealed to us later. For all creation is waiting eagerly for the future day when God will reveal with his children ready, with his children's already. Against this will, all creation was subject to God's curse. But with eager hope, the creation looks forward to the day when it will join God's glory and glorious God's children in glorious freedom for death and decay. For we know that all creation has been groaning in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. And we believe also grown even though we have the Holy Spirit within us as a foretaste for future glory. For we long for our bodies to be released for sin and suffering. We too wait with eager hope for the day when God will give us our full rights as his adopted children, including in our new bodies he has promised us. We were given his hope when we were saved. If we were already have something we don't need to hope for. If we already have something we don't need to hope for, but we look forward to something we don't have. We must wait patiently and comfortably." Coming from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verse 14 through 25. Bless the hearers and doers of his holy word. Amen.
Come on, let's clap our hands for the word of the Lord. How many of y'all can testify and declare and decree this morning that you know there's nobody greater than Jesus? He is the greatest. He's also the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And I want to make the declaration this morning that I searched all the world. I can't find anybody greater than him. He is the greatest. Do I have a witness this morning that he is the greatest? There's nobody greater than him. Help us make this next declaration. Join in and help us worship the Lord together. Come on, let's sing. Searched all over, couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater. Nobody greater. Nobody greater than you. Come on, let's sing. Sing, searched all over. Couldn't find nobody. Looked high and low. Still couldn't find nobody. Nobody great. Nobody. Nobody greater than you. Come on, let's sing it one more time all over the house. Sing, searched all over.
Couldn't find nobody.
Still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater than you. Now repeat after me and let's raise it up one big voice. Sing, your name is above all names. Couldn't find nobody. I looked high and low, I still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater. Nobody greater. Nobody greater than you. I searched all over, couldn't find nobody. Woo! I looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Looked high and low, still couldn't find nobody. Nobody greater. Nobody greater. Nobody greater than you. Your name is above all names. Your word. Said if you know his hands are mighty, clap your hands and let's give the Lord a praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for being good. I'm not worried about my problems right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for being great. You kept me all these years and you're keeping me right now. Thank you, Jesus. I may not be where I want to be, but I thank God I'm not where I used to be. Thank you, Jesus. I just gotta say thank you on the Sunday morning. Thank you, Jesus. You looked me on my boss and saw my needs. Thank you, Jesus. You keep on providing. You keep on shielding. You keep on protecting. Thank you, Jesus. If you gotta thank you one more time, come on, clap your hands and give the Lord a praise.
Day. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. And I ask This is the wonderful day the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Come on, let's celebrate our God and let's celebrate this music ministry for leading us again this morning and every Sunday morning in our time of musical praise and celebration. Listen, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus, who is the Christ. Those of you who are in person and those of you who are virtual as well, we so appreciate you being in this space with us on this morning. If you're visiting with us for the first time, would you wave your hands wherever you are? Just wave. Anybody first time, wave first time. Everybody's good. Everybody's family in the space, good. If you're online and you're worshiping with us for the first time, would you drop your information in the chat? Or would you simply scan the QR code? We would love for you to connect with us as we would love to connect with you. If you give us your information, we promise not to abuse it. We just want to continue to love on you and show you again the grace of God, the mercy of God, and the peace of God from this space of worship. Amen. And so we're grateful for all of you being in this space. Now, here's what I need you to do. As we continue to greet those who are part of this family, as we continue to greet those who are virtual, would you stand right where you are? Stand right where you are. Stand right. It's like stand, like that word, S-T-A-N-D. Stand right where you are. 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 Stand, stand. Y'all know that word stand means to rise to your feet. Everybody's there. Now go around and fellowship with family, fellowship with friends. Greet one another. Welcome them into this space. Amen. Welcome them into this space. Strangers to one another. There are a few people I'm just going to come walk up to and just see because they didn't move. I'm just going to walk up to them and say, hey, listen now. I do what you tell me to do. Y'all need to just hang it. No, just play it. Listen, it's so great to be at worship again on today. Listen, if you have not shared the worship experience, please go ahead and share that experience. Now you've been further greeted into this space. I would that you pull out your devices and share. You can share via Facebook, you can share via YouTube, you can share via the church's website. We would love to invite your family, no matter where they are in the world, to be a part of this worship experience with us on today. Amen? Amen. Well, it's time for us to give. Amen? Amen. We are always excited when God gives us the opportunity to give. Amen? Again, God did not have to give, but he gave. Because he gave, we give. We give that so that we can be blessings to others, so that we can again extend the gospel of Jesus Christ from this space into the rest of the world. Amen. So I want to invite you to grab again your gifts, your tithes, and your offerings. Don't forget First Baptist. This is the second Sunday as we continue to give above our tithe and above our offering into vision. Amen. Into vision. And we're excited about God continuing to expand that opportunity of vision. I was just speaking last Sunday about us reaching the point, and we determined this year that as we give, so we will purchase. And And so we've reached the point where we're preparing to go ahead and grab a few of those iPads for our children's center. And so we're excited about that. So thank you for your giving. Thank you for your sacrifice above and beyond your tithes and offering. We are glad to always be able to provide the best for our church, best for our children, best for our youth. Amen. And so we want them to be able to learn in a high-speed space. We don't want them to go to school, to go home and be in a high-speed space and then come to church and we're in horses and buggies talking about giddy up. Are y'all listening to me? Amen. So we need to be better at our sacrifice of giving if you are not already. Don't forget also, this is April, so our church anniversary, we're celebrating 156 years. And so we're excited about God giving us life in this community for 156 years. This church organized, again, in the Brush Harbor or Bush Harbor by slaves. And then our first pastor, Pastor W.T. Webb, who set the foundation for us as a church fellowship to, again, strive to be in this space. So as they strived and as they gave and as they sacrificed with less than we had, to give us this opportunity, how much more should we, with all that we have, provide an opportunity for the next generation to be in this space and worship? Can I tell you that you're worshiping in this building that was built by, again, members of this church over 74 years ago? And so we're thankful for this fellowship. We used to be, again, downtown. They moved over here, walked this way, and we're grateful. Was downtown Ellison, y'all know I gotta, you know, Jackson is so different. You know, I have to realize what downtown and the side of town was. But we were around this town, amen. I gotta get my geographics right, because I think about downtown in Memphis, and I'm like, you know, so y'all pray for me. I'm still learning Jackson. But again, we were, again, worshiping in a space where we were considered the slaves of a church fellowship until God gave gift and we organized fellowship. And then we were called First Colored Baptist Church, not First Baptist Church, First Colored Baptist Church when we were organized, or the Colored First Baptist Church when we were organized. That's what's on our paperwork in its initial inception, and God has moved us over the years and transitioned us. And so we're glad to be able to celebrate this space that God has gifted to us and the properties that he's allowed us to purchase in this area as we seek to do greater work for him. Amen. So again, as we prepare to give, know that you're giving into good ground. We believe what? We ought not come before the Lord's presence empty-handed. And we ought to come before the Lord's presence with laughter, because the Lord loves what? A cheerful giver. Amen. Everybody has envelopes. If you need them, raise your hand online. We'd love for you to participate with us in this time of giving on today. Information is being placed on the screen. And even for those of you who are in the sanctuary who give technologically, you can simply scan the QR code. It'll take you to one of our giving platforms. You can give via the app Givelify. You can give via our website. You can give via text to give. You can give via our Church by Ministry 1, or you can mail your gifts to the church. We would love to have you participate in the great work that God has called us to in this space. Amen. Everybody ready to give? Grab your gifts. Lift them with me. Father, thank you for every gift. Thank you for every giver. Now, Lord, bless these gifts as we use them, Lord, with proper distribution to meet the needs of the ministry that you've called us to. And God, we'll be careful to give you praise. All glory indeed belongs to you. This is our prayer. These are your gifts in Jesus' name. Amen and praise God. Listen, if you're in our side sections and you're giving physically on today, would you stand? Would you stand? Would you stand? If you're giving physically on today, would you stand? Coming around from the back to the front. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. If you're in our middle section, you're giving physically on today, would you come at this time? And giving. And we're grateful to our God always when He gives us the opportunity to give. Amen. Come on, put your hands together. Let's celebrate our music and worship arts ministry as they come at this time.
Person, I find revelation in everything. If you go to an amusement park, look at the roller coasters. There are two types of roller coaster riders. There's one like me, who's very quiet, holds on to the bar real tight. And then you have another one, they just throw up their hands and scream, ah! The weird part about it is me, who's sitting there trying to be all cool about it. And I'm holding everything in. I'm feeling all those drops way more than the people that have their hands up shouting. And it just seems like in this season, it just seems like God is purposely putting me through a little bit of roller coaster action, some rises and some falls, just to see. And for once, I was just, Jesus! Jesus! I can't do this by myself. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Break every cycle, to break all these cycles, to break all these cycles, to end all these cycles, do away with these cycles, help me in these cycles, work on me, Jesus. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Come on, let's thank our God for, again, our somatic presentation in liturgical expression. Amen. We thank our liturgical dance ministry for always preparing themselves to be responsible, again, in this moment of sharing the gospel, a gospel and music presentation. Luke chapter 9. And I want to begin reading at verse 23. Luke chapter 9. I'll be reading from the New Living Translation. Sister Springer, it's good to see you on this morning. Amen. We're thankful to have you back in worship. I know we spoke on yesterday, and you shared you were going to try to be in this space, and we're still praying for you and your entire family. And good to see you. Luke 9, verse 23, it shares these words. Then he said to the crowd, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way. Take up your cross daily and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world, but are yourself lost or destroyed? If anyone is ashamed of me and my message, the Son of Man will be ashamed of that person when he returns in his glory and in the glory of the Father and the holy angels. I tell you the truth, some standing here right now will not die before they see the kingdom of God. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated in the Lord's presence. If you want to be his follower, that's what I want to talk about this morning. If you want to be his follower. Nathan C. Schaefer writes that at the close of life, the question will not be, how much have you gotten, but how much have you given? Not how much have you won, but how much have you done? Not how much have you saved, but how much have you sacrificed? It will be, how much have you loved and served, not how much were you honored? Church, Jesus and his disciples, according to verse 18 of this same chapter, has separated themselves from the crowd. He has called them to the side for a moment of prayer. Beloved, as they are in this moment of purposed intimacy, Jesus raises a question of critical analysis to these 12. And that question is, who do people say I am? It is a probing question, but a surface question, seeing that Jesus, as he walked with these men, was seeking at every turn to develop them into who he had earlier called them to be. Church, in reply, the disciples respond with several crowd-pleasing names in which gave a certain traditional image that these persons had been exposed to in their diverse populaces. Some say John the Baptist, while others asserting that you are Elijah, and still others contending that you are one of the other ancient prophets who has risen from the dead. Family, these answers, so freely given, were also possibly a part of the inner thoughts of the 12. As they wrestled with this Jesus who had arrested their attention and still captures their intrigue as he becomes even the more endeared to their hearts. Beloved, it is for this reason that I believe Jesus engages in this critical dialogue. Because to become who they must be, they must be clear as to who he is, so that their witness might be personal and potent. So Jesus follows up with his second question of his identity, not for him, as if he had suffered some type of amnesia, or for the crowd, as if he needed their applause, for they were not around, but for these who are and will become, according to Acts chapter 1, verse 8, his witnesses. You remember that verse? It says, telling the people about him everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. But who, Jesus then asks them, do you say that I am? He begins his question with this conjunction, but indicating that there is in the question a distinct contrast between who you have said and who you see. Peter replies, you are the Messiah, which is a Hebrew term, or the Christ, which is a Greek term, both meaning the anointed one, the one who was sent from God. Family, Jesus then better clarifies this declaration of Peter's, giving its origin of inspiration in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 16, verse 17, where you'll find these words, you are blessed, Simon, son of John, because my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You did not learn this from any human being. Church, his confirming of Peter's response that Jesus in Luke's gospel, then he would warn his disciples not to make this known to anyone. Family, his desire at this time in the text was to remain concealed until such time as the Father would have him to be disclosed. Jesus, we can surmise from the text, was always about the greater plan of the Father, not the earthly platitudes and praise or applause of men and women. And he would warn them, arming them now with his own prediction of death, further making clear that this is more to me than just this. You'll find that in verse 22 where he says, the Son of Man must suffer many terrible things, he said. He will be rejected by the elders, the leading priests, and the teachers of religious law. He will be killed, but on the third day, he will be raised from the dead. He, Jesus, then calls to himself now the crowd after this moment of intimacy with his disciples, the text says, and now in front of the disciples and the crowd, Jesus, for the first time, makes clear what it will mean for those who will come after him, what it will require for them who desire to be not his member, not his brother or sister, or even his father's child, but his disciple. Hear these words afresh again. I've read them to you. And allow them to capture or recapture your attention as we proceed into the text. Then he said to the crowd, beginning at verse 23, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way. Take up your cross daily and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but are yourself lost or destroyed? If anyone is ashamed of me and my message, the Son of Man will be ashamed of that person when he returns in his glory and the glory of the Father. The holy angels, I tell you the truth, some standing here right now will not die before they see the kingdom of God. Did you see it? It's in the text. Did you miss it? If you want to be his follower, Jesus says first in the text that you must acquire the daily disciplined work
of denying yourself and at the same time possessing your cross. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus says, if you want to be my follower, not just a follower, not just their follower, but my follower, my disciple, then you have to, again, acquire the daily discipline, the work of denying self and possessing your cross. Jesus shares this in verses 23 through 25. He says you got to have discipline. It's a daily discipline that you have to take on. Discipline, you know what that word means, having or exhibiting discipline. Discipline, training to act in accordance with rules. It is synonymous with words like, I like these, cultivation, development, education, practice, preparation, self-control. He says you have to have the daily discipline to put in the work, the labor, the toil, of denying yourself, refraining from satisfying one's desires, to reject those desires, to take ownership of what you don't own and possess the cross, which means you have to take the cross and embrace it as if it's your own property, as if you own it. I know y'all don't like it. Let's walk through the text. Church, Jesus says to the disciples whom he has called and to the crowd who he has chosen to follow, that to follow me is going to require of you a daily discipline, the intentional labor of rejecting your right to control the outcome of your life, surrendering to the greater call and the greater will of Christ in your life, which beckons for you to embrace a cross. Come here, your cross. Family, Jesus here is not presenting a one-time act or activity, but a daily repetitive act on behalf of the one who chooses to come after him. He says you have to daily reject your own desires to handle your own business. And at the same time, while you're rejecting it, you have to embrace as your own property your cross. If, Jesus says, you're going to be my follower, my disciple, my pupil, my learner, then the first thing you have to do is relinquish your perceived right of ownership to a life that you did not give yourself. Back to the one who gifted the life to you in the first place. And then embrace the life that is ahead of you, which requires of you an embracing of not just my death on the cross Jesus is sharing, but your life carrying your own cross. It was Martin Luther, that reformer, who said that a religion that gives nothing, a religion that costs nothing, a religion that suffers nothing is worth nothing. I hear Paul affirming this in Romans chapter 12. I know you need Bible because you're a Bible church. That's how we've been raised. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2 says, and so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and what? Holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. Child of God, Jesus says to come after him, to follow him, means that there is not a cross in your future, hear me, but there is the daily labor of carrying your cross in the present as you are walking into your future, with each requiring of us the practice, the preparation, and self-control of rejecting who we once were in sin, taking as to own our cross that now identifies us with him as it further solidifies our work for him. I'm working too hard at 8 o'clock. Let me just go and get finished. Now, to be clear, this word cross was not a nice word back in the first century. The cross was not something that you wore around your neck or had tattooed on your body. The cross in the first century was an emblem of suffering and an emblem of shame. It was a device of torture that was invented by the Persians and perfected by the Romans to inflict the greatest amount of pressure and pain over the longest amount of time. Jesus' church chooses the most horrific symbol of the culture and says to those who will come after him, will you bear your cross? And will you bear this daily? Charles Haddon Spurgeon would say that there are no crown wearers in heaven who were not first cross bearers on earth. Can I tell you so that we can all be clear what a cross is not? Because I hear people saying this, I'm just bearing my cross. Can I tell you what a cross is not? One writer shares it lovingly this way, and I'll continue to expound, that a cross is not your hardships. I need y'all to hear me. A cross is not an unfair employer. That's not a cross. A cross is not a wrong professor or a misguided teacher. That's not a cross. A cross is not your mean mother-in-law or your obtuse father. Y'all, you know, I'm trying to give y'all good words. Obtuse father-in-law. Can I tell y'all, it's not even the illnesses that we carry around in these bodies. All of us have sickness, but your sickness is not your cross. Can I share with you what a cross is? Crosses are the results of what happens when we decide to walk in the footsteps of Christ. Crosses come from standing on business for the sake of the gospel. Vance Havner said these words, we need men of the cross with the message of the cross, bearing the marks of the cross. We need men and women of the cross with the message of the cross, bearing the marks of the cross. Jesus' church says simply but yet profoundly that those who try to hang on to their lives will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you'll save it. Beloved, Jesus lovingly submits to us that to try and keep your life is to ultimately lose the life you're trying to keep. But when you place your life, turn it over to him, surrendering your life for the sake of him, that's when you save it. Because what benefit is it of yours to hang on to your life and gain the whole world, and at the same time that you're adding the world to your life, you're losing yourself and you're preparing yourself for destruction? So while you're trying to reach your personal earthly ambitions at the expense of your personal relationship with God, while you're gaining on earth, you're losing when it comes to heaven. What is it for a man or woman to have all the praise of men and women on earth, the ambitions of your heart, your proverbial heart's desire? What do you benefit from that? If in gaining it, you're at one and the same time letting go of God, thus losing your life, while you're trying to obtain what looks like life. Jesus says that he came that we might have life and have, watch, that life more abundantly, which suggests that there is a life that we have yet to realize that he possesses and desires for us to possess and to enjoy. What good is it to have the idea of power and prestige and wealth and lose the most valuable piece of who you are, which is your soul? You found comfort for your earthly accoutrements and amenities, but you lose the very essence and core of who you are. Family, Jesus speaks to this because he knows something about this. You remember Luke chapter 4, right? It's Luke's version of what is the wilderness experience of Jesus as he's recounting his time in the wilderness, as he's led into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil, right? And so in verses 5 through 7, you'll find these words as he struggles for us and examples for us how to keep life. Then the devil took him up and revealed to him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. He flashes them before him at one time. I will give you the glory of these kingdoms and authority over them, the devil said, because they are mine to give to anyone I please. I will give it to you if you will only worship me. Jesus replies, the scripture says, you must worship the Lord your God only and serve him only. Ladies and gentlemen, can I tell you that the devil can't give you what he does not own? And many of you are seeking to own what he's trying to get you to possess at the expense of who God has called you to be. I'm not saying it's wrong for you to live and enjoy the earth that God has provided and even the amenities of this earth. But when the amenities and the earth take precedent and priority over the giver, then we have a problem. Because how can you worship what has been given and forget about the giver? Child of God, self-satisfaction always proves to be the enemy of being godly generous to ourselves and those who are around us. We have been redeemed and reinvigorated and regenerated to do what? Be just like him. What benefits a man to gain the whole world? What benefits a woman to gain the whole world and then lose? You need an example. Let me see if I can reach way back for you. I know y'all don't like history, but since my major is church history, my minor rather is church history, let me just reach back into my classroom days. It was 180 years after the death of Charlemagne, about the year 1000, officials of the Emperor Otho opened the great king's tomb, where in addition to incredible treasures, they saw an amazing sight. Here's what they saw. They saw the skeletal remains of King Charlemagne seated on a throne. His crown was still on his skull. A copy of the Gospels was lying in his lap, and his little bony finger, they said, was pointing to a specific verse. And the verse that they say his bony finger was pointing to was this: for what does it profit a man? Y'all missed it. If he gains the whole world and loses and forfeits his soul. Can I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that the devil can't take your soul from God, and God does not ever want to let you go. He does not want to release you from his hand because he loves you. But can I tell you something? You can walk out of it. You can forfeit your relationship with him. We just talked about Judas. Judas was with him, around him, walked with him, and saw all the things the Lord had done in miracles and still sold him out. for 30 pieces of silver. And some of us in here will sell Jesus for less than that. And we do it on a daily basis. Come here. There's something else in the text. I'm working with time today. Good. Here it is. Secondly, church, if we're going to follow him, we must perform daily now the work of owning him and his word without shame. Verse 26, here it is. If anyone is ashamed here and now of me and my message, the Son of Man will be ashamed of that person when he returns in his glory and in the glory of the Heavenly Father and the holy angels. Not only do we have to do the daily work of denying self and embracing our cross, we have to also do the daily work while at the same time of denying and embracing, of owning him and his word without shame. Can I tell you that we cannot be ashamed, distressed, or embarrassed when it comes to our Christ and his gospel with feelings of guilt or foolishness or disgrace when it comes to our Christ? We must own him in every way, or not own him at all. Isn't it amazing? Hear me now. I'm wrapping up. Isn't it amazing how people will own you when you talk about God? You can say anything you want about God, and that's because they use that term plurally to attach to multiple spaces of religion. God, 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 God. But when it comes to Christianity, that term takes on a different affinity because it's God the Father. There's a sense of intimacy. So when you start talking about God, everybody's okay, right? Everybody's all right when you use those messed up terms like, again, the guy next door, right? Are you listening? Y'all ever heard those? The person upstairs. Well, the person upstairs for me is a squirrel because it's an attic. You understand what I'm saying? We try to make it so common that we diffuse and dilute the very powerful and creative existence of a Father who has created, right? And so here we are, and he says to them, he said, I don't need you to be ashamed, but everybody's cool when you talk about God. But here's what they get upset when you start talking about Jesus. Why? Because Jesus is a dividing line. Jesus comes as the incarnate. But not only is he incarnate, he's the Son of God, he's the Son of Man. Jesus is also the Redeemer and the ransom at the same time. He's the reinvigorator as well as the regenerator at the same time. Are y'all listening to me? And so when you talk about Jesus, you're not talking about a religion anymore. And that's why people get upset, because Jesus is not a religion. He's a relationship. Are y'all listening to me? Because he says, in me, you might have life and have it more abundantly, which means outside of me is death, but in me is life. Outside of me is ruin and destruction, but in me is success and achievement. Always there's a problem with Jesus, because here's what Jesus has the tendency to do. He has the tendency to run counterculture. I can't unpack that. It's 8 o'clock. We ain't got that much time. Y'all gotta listen. Go back 12 years ago and just start listening from there. And when you get to this lesson right here, then you'll understand what I'm talking about. Jesus always runs counterculture. Family, in essence, there will be days when people won't appreciate you, won't be your friend, and won't enjoy your conversation. And while you're talking, they'll be frowning. But here's the test. Can you own him even when they don't like him anymore? Y'all know how we do each other. Y'all know how we do each other. Because we disown each other in a minute because somebody start talking. Yeah, I don't like them neither. I don't like that about them either. They make me sick too. When I come in the morning, they all smiling and bubbly. And I be trying to figure out what's the smile about? Why you so, you know, I don't like that about. And then come back to them and say, hey, how you doing? Good morning to you. Your buddies and your not buddies all at the same. Your friends and your not friends. You're on Facebook together and you're not on Facebook. You receive one moment and you block the next moment, all because of what you decide and choose to follow. But Jesus says, when it comes to me, listen, I need people who are not ashamed of me, nor are they ashamed of the gospel. Here's what he's pushing them. I need you to understand that when I die on Calvary, don't drop your doggone head. Don't walk off and leave as if I'm undone. I've been telling you for too long that I'm going to die and be raised again. How dare you be ashamed of me while I'm trying to save you? Are y'all? I'm done. Y'all know. That's why we have to wrestle now in this present age. I'm pushing. We have to wrestle now in this present age with people who are talking about Jesus versus people who really have Jesus. I'm watching. Not so much, but I'm watching. I still watch the news, and this group of evangelicals, they call themselves evangelicals. They really have the right term, Christian nationalists, extremists, and they're pushing this narrative outside of the... Y'all thought I wasn't going there? I'm going there. Y'all thought I was nervous? I'm not nervous. I'm good. I can handle me. I'm good. All right? Y'all all right? All right. Christian nationalists, these extremists, and they're not just white, they're black as well. These people that push this heavy narrative, less the civility of the love of Jesus. Jesus says, okay to speak the truth, but you need to pepper the truth with love. It must be foundationed with love, or your truth is unacceptable because it's not digestible. It's okay to tell somebody that they're in sin. That's okay. But how you tell them, and with what motive you tell them, and with what expression you tell them, it matters. Jesus talked to a whole lot of people that was in the crowd that was full of sin, but he never blasted them. He never called them out in public. He never pointed his finger in their bony little faces. He didn't even exact laws that were unloving. I'm done. Don't miss it. We can't be ashamed of the gospel. He's worthy of our appreciation. I hear Paul, Romans chapter 1. He says, for I am not ashamed of this good news, this gospel about Christ. Why? Because it is the power of God at work. Hear me. Saving everyone who believes. Y'all don't miss that. The Jew first and also the Gentiles. Y'all don't know. Y'all Gentiles. We Gentiles, right? Anybody who's not Jew is a Gentile. That's how you understand the context, right? All right. This good news tells us how God makes us right in his sight. This is accomplished from start to finish by faith. As the scriptures say, it is through faith that the righteous person has life. Can I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, we have to be careful. And I say this lovingly because I know my point rubs a few people the wrong way, and I didn't express it exactly how I wanted it, because if I had said it how I wanted it, it would have been tense for some people. But I need you to understand. The text says it is the power of God at work saving everyone who believes. How many of you in here are not sinners? Raise your hand. Thank you so much. How many of you in here are sinners? Raise your hand. But we are sinners saved by grace through faith, which means this, ladies and gentlemen, that God is still working on us. Ooh, y'all, I'm about to mess with somebody's television person, which means this, ladies and gentlemen, that although people are promoting their big sins on television, God is looking at every sin in the heart of men and women. And we have to be careful, ladies and gentlemen, when we're pointing out what God doesn't like, because God doesn't like any sin. While your sermons are pointed toward individuals, be careful not to be ungodly in a godly place.
I'm done.
Here it is. I need y'all to understand, I ain't condoning nobody's sin, not even my own. Because I'm like Paul, I'm the chief among sinners, which means if you want to sin, we can do it. Are you listening to me? We know how, we know when, and we know with what modes and methods. Are y'all listening to me? But because we have chosen him, we wrestle daily, waking up saying to ourselves, you can't choose that today. And then we wake up the next day and say, you can't choose that. You have to deny yourself daily those things that will cause destruction or ruin, and at the same time embrace the cross. And embracing the cross, it means embracing the message that you're better than what you're letting go. Verse 27, here it is, we're done. I tell you the truth, some standing here right now will not die before they see the kingdom of God. I like that verse. It's a simple verse, it's plugged in, it's really connected to everything, and Jesus gives it at the end, which concludes the conversation. But really, in that verse, what it's saying is, there is always more to see with Jesus. Just when you think you've seen everything, there's more. Yeah. I'm going to get a new 8 o'clock, because y'all ain't enjoying this. There's always more to see. He says, I tell you the truth, some standing here right now will not die before they see the kingdom of God. And every scholar and historian has their piece on this, right? But let me just give you, again, alongside their pieces, what I find along with them in my estimation, which is the greatest strength as I listen to the history of scholars. And that is, the next verse you'll see, Jesus takes a few disciples, and they go up on a mountain. And it's called the Mount of Transfiguration. And Jesus, in that moment, does something that we like to tag to butterflies. He has a metamorphic experience where he turns himself inside out. And they get a chance to see him in his glory. And there are two other people that are up on the mountain in vision form with them as they're there. And while they're there, you have Elijah and Moses, which is the law and, again, the power of the prophets. And so Jesus absorbs the conversation because he is now both and one at the same time. Are y'all listening to me? And so they see the kingdom of God in its glory. Now, don't stop there, because there's always more, because that wasn't the only thing that they would see. Because, ladies and gentlemen, they would then see a death on a Friday. But they would also see the kingdom rising on the first day of the week, a Sunday morning. That's an image of there's more to come, the kingdom of God. But not only that, don't just get happy there. They would not only see him rise on the third day, but they would see him over the course of the days show himself to others in resurrected form. But the celebration is that there's more to see, because they watch him ascend into glory. I talked about this last week, didn't I? And he's seated now at the right hand of the Father. But come here, because there's more to see, because one day the one who has ascended is going to descend again, and he's coming back for you and me. So the completeness of us is found in the person of Jesus Christ. And I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for its power. Yeah, to those who believe. And I wonder, is there anybody here who will follow him with me? I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back.
Is there anybody here who knows the Jesus I'm talking about? The one who has embraced you. The one who hugs you in the midnight hour. The one who wipes tears from your eyes. The one who tells you that he loves you. I'm not ashamed of him, but I'm also not ashamed of the one who died, the one who rose, the one who lives, the one who's coming. Yes! Hallelujah. Yes. 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 Oh, yeah. Come on, we got to go. Yeah. Yeah, he's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy of our attention. He's worthy of our sacrifice. He's worthy of our devotion. Every time we gather to celebrate a Christ who was so devoted to us that he gave all of who he was, even to the point of embarrassment and shame, scandal and ridicule, so that we could have life. And how dare we follow him and not decide every day to wrestle with daily the denying of ourselves. I know it's difficult, ladies and gentlemen, because the world presents a beautiful picture. It presents an awesome picture of enjoyment. It's almost like those sandy beaches when they used to have that commercial, "Come back to Jamaica." The world is presenting that to us every day. Come on back. Listen, you ain't got to worry about all that stress over there. You ain't got to worry about trying to live up to no. No, here's the thing. You ain't got to worry about that over here. You know why? Because the Bible says, he that has begun a good work will perform it. Which means this. All you have to do is surrender yourself. And the more you surrender, the more he empowers you to do the work that he's called you to do. Father, thank you today. Thank you for your word, and our desire is to follow you. So Lord, even now, we pray for those who have heard your word today. We pray for those who desire to unite with you first today. And then we pray for those, Lord, who are saved, but who may not be in fellowship. They are in the crowd, but they're not connected. We pray for connection today. And God, we'll be careful in how you decide to call these your people to yourself, this your creation to yourself. This is our prayer. These are your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Listen, real quickly, the door of the church is open. If you're not saved, listen, you need to be saved. You need to be saved. If you're saved, you need to belong somewhere. If you're here, and I mentioned this on this past Sunday at 10:30, and you're in the area, and you're away from home, whether it's working or whether it's college, and your desire is to come up under what's called watch care. We hadn't shared that word in some time. But watch care means you're in the city, you're working, you're in school, however that may be. You're just here for a small amount of time, and you're saying, this is the place that I want to belong. This is the place that I want to connect to. God is assigning me here. Then we offer Christ to you for salvation, if that's the person, and we offer relationship, connection, and family to you if you're saved but you need to belong somewhere. Not saved, you need a relationship with Christ. After a relationship with Christ, there's assignment to fellowship. Saved, but you're not connected. You're in the crowd, but God is calling you to connection. We offer Christ to you, my brother, my sister, on this morning. EJ is going to share. Those of you online, information is being placed on the screen, because we do not want to leave you out. If you're watching today or whenever you watch this broadcast through the week, we invite you to scan that QR code and connect with us. You can call the church even throughout the week. There's someone here. You can go on our website. You can email us. We'd love to have you as a part of the body of Christ
and then as a part of the family of Historic First Baptist Church. My brother, my sister, you're welcome at this time. We offer Christ to you.
Oh, my brother, we offer Christ to you. Oh, my sister,
yeah, yeah.
He will give you brand new life.
Come on, come on.
Give you life abundantly. So.
Let's put our hands together and celebrate God for the decisions that have been made on today. Amen, amen, amen. Listen, we're getting ready to transition from this space. Again, remember Christian Education, our academy happens right after worship at 8 a.m. And we're looking forward to hearing what Deacon Jackson or whoever's teaching today. I missed the rotation names. Y'all pray for me. I was talking to someone yesterday, and it's amazing now that I'm getting to the place where I walk into a room and forget what I done walked in there for. Y'all, I'm getting out of the car, and the keys right here in the cup holder where I put them about 3 minutes ago, and I'm sitting up there thinking, like, where my keys at? And this is when sin enters in, because words come out of my mouth because I'm trying to find my keys. Y'all pray for me that sin is removed from me, because my words are not wholesome and healthy at that time, because I'm mad at me. Now, I ain't talking about nobody else. I'm just mad at me because I can't. And then I look over and see my keys, and then I say, well, I'll be the Lord's friend. I'll be the Lord's friend. I'm trying to change my words. Sister Ben, ain't that right? I've been here. I've been doing good for these years now. I'll be the Lord's friend. That's not a cuss word. Even though I just said it for the first time right then, but don't forget, this is the year of discipleship. This is the year of discipleship. Don't forget, we're discipling people to Christ. Amen. That's what we've been called to do, to be disciples. Don't forget, this Wednesday, noon Bible study and evening Bible study, 12 noon and 6:30 p.m. This Wednesday, seniors, don't forget, every third Wednesday is our senior ministry fellowship. And so, again, on Wednesday, we will fellowship with our seniors in Bible study and after Bible study. Amen. Church anniversary, we're just going to celebrate on the fourth Sunday. Again, we're just going to enjoy God together. It's just going to be a big celebration. So invite family, invite friends, invite old members, invite old friends to come and to worship with us on that Sunday. I'm just trying to figure out, again, what I'm going to say, but we're going to just celebrate on that Sunday. So it's just going to be a good party. Amen. That's a good party, a good party. I'm a try not to do hard preaching that Sunday, right? I'm going to try not to do hard preaching. We're just going to shout and get happy and just go home. Amen. That's what you do at birthday parties, right? That's what you do. That's what you do. We'll probably have some cake or something like that, right? 156 years old, right? Don't forget, Mother's Day is coming up. We're looking forward to that second Sunday in May. All mothers, we want to share with you early so you can put on your calendars. Be here with us at 9:30 on Mother's Day. Mother's Day. We will not do Christian education on that Sunday because we're going to be serving breakfast to our mothers. Amen. So that Sunday, we're going to do family at the table. All right. We're just going to enjoy each other, connect with each other. All right. So that's the second Sunday at 9:30. So after worship, we'll go downstairs, have breakfast together in between our 8 a.m. and 10:30 service. All right? It'll be in the fellowship. Our birthdays this week, would you stand? Birthdays. Any? All right. Well, we know we have some. Kalia, Jay Morrison, Grayson Payne's birthday is this week. And Frances Jeter, her birthday is this week as well. Wedding anniversaries. Come on. We had some in the last time they forgot, but they remembered. So we had some. Yeah.
I mean, sometimes dates are hard to remember. I know it's not good on them when they get home, but dates are hard to remember, so I want to make sure. That's why I try to do it in church so y'all can at least have a recall moment before you get to the house. Amen. Hey there. Thank you, Deacon Dre. Thank you, Deacon Dre. Thank you. Deacon Darnell is with me. Amen. You want to have that moment. Pastor looking out for you. Amen. Because then you get home, whole day going bad. Then you get home and say, what's wrong with you? You forgot what today is. Then you can go in there and pull out something you done bought years ago and put a bow on it and give it to him. Amen. All right. All right. I want to make sure, Sister Lakita Darnell, you know, we were voting for her through the week. We were voting for her through the week, the month of March, for, again, Teacher of the Month. And thank you. She sends her thanks because she was, again, selected as Teacher of the Month. So we thank God for Ms. Lakita Darnell and what she means to our school system and how she has continued to work in that space. Come on, let's stand together. Let's stand together. Men, do y'all see the screen? Y'all got it? So I'll see y'all tomorrow night at what time? 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock. All men. All men. Men and fathers and sons. 6 o'clock. Tomorrow we'll be in this space at this church in the fellowship hall. We'll be gathering together. I'm looking forward to our time of instruction, our time of fellowship, our time of prayer. Amen. 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 Look this way. Let me bless you. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to smile upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift the light of the countenance of his presence upon you and give you his peace in your laughter and in your leisure, in your frustration and even in your tears, until we shall all one day sit at the feet of Jesus where there is no sunrise or sunset. Listen, God bless y'all. I love y'all. Have a great week. Have a great week.